Welcome to the Windy Hill Windsock. With me, the Solution, and joining me today is Fiona.
Hey, Solution, we're back. You promised.
Yep. Second week in a row, Fiona's forecast. Interesting reaction last week. The Windsock 2000 messaged me and he told me it was the Harry Jones bash cast. Oh. So we'll maybe get to Harry a little bit later, but
do the people want honesty from me, or do they want me to just, you know, pat the bums? What do we want?
Oh, look, they want your opinion. That's pretty clear. So keep stating your opinion.
Because I can't, when I go into the defence of your Devin Smiths, I get bashed. When I go for criticising fairly so, in my opinion, I get bashed. I'll please everyone.
To be honest, I mean, if you really want to mention Dev Smith Gate again, he'd had like three possessions and four tackles, and you tried to claim he was in the best. But anyway, we'll move on. The difference that a week makes is amazing. So this time last week, in previewing the game, we thought, are we going to be in the tank conversation? I reckon Hawthorn have that stitched up. They are bad. But we looked surprisingly good, so much so that at the end of our normal pod last week, I'm pretty sure that you and some others had a range of between 30 and 50 points. Are we still feeling this confident?
Look, no. As I suspected, as I predicted, by Wednesday, the dust had settled ever so slightly. And we'll get to our, you know, exact predictions later, but I'm definitely feeling much more grounded. And I'm starting to feel a little bit nervy about the what ifs. But, I'm no longer on the 50-point win train.
Okay. Well, so there was one change. Waller pulled up sore, which is a little bit concerning. I had this horrible thought that imagine that's the extent of his comeback. And he can never quite get his fitness. There is a world where that happens, but God, I hope it doesn't, because he looks so good.
I mean, as I've said previously, you could just leave him in that little forward pocket, and if he did two rundown tackles in the forward line per game, kicked two to three goals, or even one goal per game, that's still a good day out. You know, he still would worry defenders.
Yeah. Defenders will be paying attention to him. But anyway, he's out. Hopefully he improves really quick. We have an extended bench. And I guess how does it work? We need to choose a sub now, don't we? It's unchanged otherwise.
It's exactly pretty much out of the four emergencies will come the sub. So the emergencies as they are Guelphy, Massimo, Baldwin, and the fourth. Who's the fourth? You were having a bit of a look-see. We had to stay on trend for Fiona's forecast and be unprepared, statless.
Did he win the Henneman of the Year last year?
Stuart. You said that was Stuart.
No, that wasn't last year. Oh, he's my prediction for this year.
Who?
The Henneman of the Year last year was Will Snelling.
Oh, Snello. Yes, that's it. Yep.
So Snelling's the other one. Oh, look, who would you like to see come in? Baldwin's been spending the preseason down in defence, hasn't he?
He has, yeah. Which, look, you know how I mentioned in our proper pod on Sunday that should one of our touchwood defenders go down, we have no backup. I actually think I was reading the Essendon coaches' minds, and that's probably why they're training Baldwin down there as a just in case.
Yeah. Are you? Can you read minds as well as you can? Prevent injuries, because
exactly.
You told us.
I have.
Yeah. Baldwin comes in?
No, in answer to your question, I'd like to see Guelphy get rewarded for his end of season form last year. I think he really carried the forward line, as Brad Scott has mentioned a few times in his press conferences, and I'd like to see him come in and be rewarded for that. Who do you think will come in? Or do you want to see?
I think you normally see the most versatile player possible come in. I guess Guelphy can play a couple of roles, even though he's kind of made his name as a small forward. I guess it makes sense, like Waller's a small forward.
Well, you could argue Massimo, he's versatile and can play both ends.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I think it's out of those two. Yeah, we shall see. Notably, Jake Stringer coming back via the reserves. Great signs for us, I think, for two reasons. One, he's getting fit and hopefully he'll be back soon. Mm-hmm. And two, I think it's good he's made to play a game in the twos and not necessarily just waltz back in.
But it did make me question, why is Jones not playing in the twos?
Are we seriously going to go down the Jones?
No, but it's like tick for tat. Why, after he came off injury, he missed.
Look, this is, we've already established Harry Jones's mum. Yeah. What's that expression, dog with a bone? I think it's because Wright went down. Well, look, we need that extra tall, and I thought he played well last week, so yeah. I thought he played relatively well.
Before the listeners come for me, I was being facetious and I'm having a little joke.
Okay. I've got his family asking for my home address, so I'm feeling a little bit vulnerable.
You mean my home address? I'm going to start in the mail.
They're blaming me. They're after Windsock Towers. They're trying to sue me, basically. But, I think it's great news, and he will make. Look, if we can get over this week with a win, I know you said 50 points last week, but even if we win by a point and then Stringer can work back in and become fit and healthy and play a number of consecutive games in a row, I think it'll certainly the blow of losing Wright will be lessened by that.
Look, I'd love, all I want to hear pretty much at 4:30 tomorrow is obviously we'll still be mid-game, but I want to hear Jake Stringer got through the VFL unscathed, is good to go, had a good game, kicked four and got through unscathed. That's exactly what I want to read.
Yeah, agreed. All right, so what do we – so this is Fiona's forecast. What are you forecasting we need to worry about when it comes to the Gold Coast? What's our biggest concern? I don't think it's Levi Casbolt. Let me just put that out there.
Yeah, look, you'd really, really like to think that one of Zerk, Thatcher or Laverty would be able to take him. I'm quite surprised that the Suns favoured him over Chol, Marbor Chol.
Yeah. Yep.
They dropped Chol. So he's clearly, Casbolt is in favour. I think they're strong, their defensive, their backline is quite strong. Lukosius is a really good player. I think their midfield is also quite strong. So I think our backs should be under control, in my opinion. Our midfield and forward line will have to be on top of their game. And to be to be quite honest, it's so funny because watching the replay, 73 times as I have, you forget how different your opinion is when you're watching it live at the game, at the ground, versus when you watch it on TV. Your opinion on players, their form is completely different. Like, I saw all the feedback saying that our first quarter was quite bad, but at the ground at the time, we weren't thinking that. We were thinking that we'd done pretty all right. And rewatching the game a few times like I have, I actually think, even though he was tagged, I actually think Zach Merritt had an even better game than Parrish did. Parrish's clearance work was sublime, don't get me wrong. But I thought, like, credit where's due, Zach Merritt had a brilliant game in terms of his one percenters, his energy, his effort. He exuded every little last bit of energy he had in him. I thought he did some really little kind of one percenters that went unnoticed.
Which has maybe been a criticism of him in recent years, that he's maybe not quite been defensively as good as we know he can be. Dare I say, he's risen to the role of captain.
And if I want to be negative Nancy, I say, why did it take the captaincy for him to do that? But we shall not go down that path.
No, no, we shall not. All right. So your again, your forecast. Now, this pod, like I must admit, sometimes it's just a vehicle for puns or for dodgy segments or dodgy segment names. We do need to talk about the herd and the Henneman, but I might save that conversation for tomorrow. We had some interesting feedback through the week. But, yes, we're going to award. So you're going to give me who you predict.
Hey, give it a better intro than that.
Well, you go.
No, you go. I had the idea. You just need to talk it up a bit more.
That's right. We were kicking around via text. You were saying, do we call like the first goal scorer who that might be? Because we want to earn people money, by the way. We want people to leave Fiona's forecast, take some equity a bit out of their home,
exactly,
and go and put multiple thousands of dollars on bets and then thank us later.
That's right.
So we were going to talk about maybe first goal scorer. We'll call him the Lloydy. Mm-hmm. Maybe who has the least handballs in the game. We might call him the Lucas.
Yep.
And anyway, what I've settled on is we're going to go with the Joe dichotomy, the Joe dichotomy, which is who's going to be the smoking Joe, as in who's going to tear it up tomorrow. And I think the thing about the smoking Joe is it's too easy to say Parrish or Merritt. Who's really going to kind of take the game by the scruff of the neck? I think those guys will be a constant, pretty good all year.
And rack up the disposals. We don't want the highest disposal getter. Yeah. This is who's going to make a difference. And if they weren't there on the day, would we have won? That's the theme, right, for the smoking Joe.
Yeah, that's the theme. That's the smoking Joe. And then
this is my fave.
Yeah. Who's going to be the sitting Joe? So the smoking Joe is obviously, we've established, the sitting Joe is probably just going to be the Henneman with her. It's just another way of saying Henneman. But it's going to be the person who, or the footballer who, you know, won't necessarily be worst on ground, but will underperform relative to what he can do and what he normally does.
And how did you say it to me? How did you say it to me in the text?
I can't remember. What did I say?
About the fence?
He would have been better off on the fence, sitting on the fence. Yeah.
So
yeah.
What's it called? The Joe,
Sitter, yeah. Smoking so Joe, the sitting Joe.
So the sitting Joe is, you all should know where that reference is coming from. Is that which player are we going to choose? Are we going to anticipate being better off just sitting on the fence the whole game?
Correct. Now I think we're officially labouring the point. But,
yes, can we get it across?
So who's going to be the smoking Joe?
Oh, but no, can I just preface this to all the listeners is that this is all in good fun. We love all the boys. This is just, we're just having a laugh. We would go to war for them
But hang on a second.
Maybe not, but we're just having a bit of fun.
I know what you're saying, but let's be real here. Essendon has a history. Ask Paul Salmon.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Ask Kevin Walsh. We do like a whipping boy. Let's be frank and honest about this. We do like a whipping boy. So it's not always that we've loved everybody equally, shall we say. But anyway, can you fucking give it, please?
Okay.
Who is the smoking Joe tomorrow?
Okay, the smoking Joe, I'm going to give the smoking Joe to Sammy Durham. Okay. I think he's going to love the smaller ground at Marvel. I think he's going to run his guts off up and down that wing. And I just think he's going to have fun tomorrow. I think he's going to make a difference.
I seem
very tempted to give it to my bae, to Perko, coming off a good performance, but I don't want people to call me biased, so I'm going with Dazza.
Yeah, I say it's funny you say about him and Marvel. I have very distinct images in my head of him playing really well at Marvel a number of times last year.
Yeah, because he loves it. It's a smaller ground, narrower. I'm the same. I can see him going up and down that wing.
And he kind of can drift forward and take a mark too. That's what I'd like to see.
Loves a mark. And he gut runs up and down, won't stop until you stop him, you physically stop him.
Beautiful. So he's going to be the smoking Joe. Who's going to be the sitting Joe?
Look, I'm going to go.
Who would we rather see on the fence?
Did you hear what I said?
No, I missed it. Sorry.
Look, I'm going to go Jones. No, I'm kidding. Not going to be Jones. Relax. We'll never see him sitting on a fence. He's way too good for that. Don't you worry, Bombers fans.
You can't help yourself, can you? Anyway.
I mean that. He's way too good to be in the conversation of the actual who the award is named after. But anyway.
Okay. I must have pulled a sarcasm muscle today because I'm struggling to.
Yeah. Do I need to hold up a sarcasm sign? So you can
maybe,
see that?
Maybe.
Okay. Who am I going to go with? I don't want to go with the obvious ones.
You want me to go?
Yeah. Can you give it? Because you give it for this week, and I'll rise above next week.
I reckon Setterfield might have a second game Bomber Blues. I reckon he might just come back to the pack a little.
You reckon? Okay.
Yeah, he might garner a little bit of attention this week. I think he was kind of allowed to do what he wanted last week.
You reckon he played above his weight?
Well, Jez, who assures me he'll be on the podcast tomorrow, did call him a spud.
When I threw it in his face via text last week, he was still on his spud train.
He was resolute. reminds me of someone. I reckon he might come back to the pack. So I think tomorrow he might be the sitting Joe.
Okay, that's an interesting one. Interesting one. I was going to give it. I'll give a runner up to maybe Laverty, but I'm hoping he gets over his, funk and comes out and has a good game.
Yeah, look, I'm sure he will. By the way, what did you think of Langford down back?
Surprisingly good. I spoke to a few people who had him as their best on ground. So
interesting. Okay.
Very and multiple people at that. Multiple different people in different groups of that I know them from different groups had them. One Jesmond had him as best on ground. So I thought it was. I thought his second half was good. I thought his first half was a little shaky, but I thought he's. I think it's worth continuing the experiment. What do you think?
Yeah, he just uses the ball well. And maybe he's a good antidote to our vice captain sometimes, who can cough it up.
I thought he was good though.
He was.
I was going to say, like, if he wants to keep Massimo and Hind out of the team, he needs to do exactly what he did last week. He needs to come off half back with speed. He needs to hit targets, and he's got to be that, if need be, that pressure back.
And he's actually an elite runner, and I think he needs to use it. When he put his head down a couple of times, I thought, that's what we kind of envisaged him doing when we drafted him. But I we'll go to predictions now. I'll start. I reckon I said 15 points last week. I do think Gold Coast will bounce back. They were awful last week. I do think they're a better team than what they displayed.
Mm-hmm.
I think we'll win by about three goals, and I think it will be a comfortable three goals. So we'll probably get an early lead, and it'll drift between 20, 18, 25 points for most of the game. And comfortable and Essendon are two things that are synonymous with each other.
No.
What do you reckon?
I agree. I think the Suns will bounce back, but I also think that given it's an away game, I think they'll be pretty intimidated by the Marvel atmosphere. I think we'll be full to the brim of confidence.
Stopping on that point, Brad Scott did beat the war drum.
He did. I love
that. Yeah. He wants the fans to be a 19th man.
He wanted everyone up and about. So I hope, you know, I hope they do. It's our first home game. I hope everyone does get down to Marvel. I'll certainly be there. I do think the Suns will be intimidated by the atmosphere. I think we'll be head full of confidence. They'll be on adrenaline. And I do think that it'll be a pretty comfortable 22-23 points win.
That'd be nice.
I think we'll probably be a bit more than that, but I'm staying a little bit conservative.
Yeah, so you basically halved the...
I did.
You halved the margin from Sunday.
Well, wouldn't it be good if it's 50 points, hey?
It would be nice. I must admit, a little part of me, as I started to enjoy all the social media, my favourite thing when we win is just waiting for Charlie Don's clips to come out.
Yeah.
And he's a huge friend of the pod. But I reckon by sort of Tuesday, I did start to think as a supporter base, okay, guys, we've won round one against the pretty poor Hawthorn. Let's just calm the farm. But it was good because the media were pushing a narrative about Essendon's off-field stuff this week. And it was nice to be able to just ignore it and just enjoy the actual football content.
You're right. It's a good point. Yeah. I you know, usually that'd kind of put a damper in things, but it really didn't. And, yeah, I think by that Wednesday for me, I started to think, oh, my God, like Melbourne will beat Hawthorn by 100 points, you know. That's not how kind of pessimistic I kind of went. But, look, I think it was the first game of the season. Hmm. I think if we're going to really, you know, talk the talk, then we need to back it up tomorrow with a really similar win in terms of contest, pressure, and what was the other thing? Hitting targets, laying, you know, putting the pressure on, defensively setting up. We need to be consistent. I don't want to see the polar opposite, because that's what I'm still not in the Brad Scott era. I'm still in the previous eras, and I'm expecting us to be, you know, completely opposite that we were last week.
Drinking our own bathwater this week, and then suddenly we drop
off. That's right.
I don't think Brad Scott will allow that to happen. Yeah, exactly right. I've got no doubt. Like he's going through the honeymoon period. There'll be times later in the year where we, like, particularly, I don't think we'll make finals. I still maintain that.
Yeah.
And there will be people that become frustrated or whatever. But I do think the one thing that we will see is a more consistent effort. We won't see those 70-point shellackings where halfway through the first quarter you go, fuck it, might as well just go to the bar. There's no point being here.
Yeah. And how good is that as a supporter to know that that shit won't be tolerated? Like, that is what you get, but from a coach who's of the ilk of Brad Scott. Like, you just know that it won't be tolerated. And if it happens, which it probably will, let's be honest, we'll have one bad shellacking. It's on the cards. Like, I just feel like, you know what, I know next week this is not going to happen, or I know that, you know, some players are going to be dropped and held accountable. Do you know what I mean? Like, I feel safe in his hands knowing that it won't be tolerated, that kind of those habits, you know, that kind of behaviour. But, hey, you know, the top four sitting the live ladder, Collingwood, Carlton, Richmond, Essendon. I saw Dane Swan tweet, imagine if the season ended like this, Melbourne Town would blow up. Imagine.
Can't we just pray for another Wuhan virus that shuts everything down? Like,
I mean,
Omni Mega Godzilla Chrom COVID bird swan.
What kind of animal should we? Today I saw a camel on a delivery. I delivered, had to drive out to Mount Macedon. So I tell you what, there was no one around. I was in the bush. If someone wanted to kill me and bury me, no one would ever know. No one would miss me, nothing. But I was driving along, turned my head. I usually see horses and cows. Camel.
Yeah.
Camel.
What, just in a paddock?
In a paddock, yep. By himself.
One hump or two?
Two. Two humps. That's how I think was a camel.
Are they called a dromedary? I think they might be. Or I just made that up.
Go on, check. We need some trivia for...
No, we'll address that tomorrow.
Okay. Oh, One other thing I wanted to bring up with you, and because Charlie, you know, we've already mentioned Charlie, but Charlie's love child is debuting in the VFL. The very, very exciting Mankara, Anthony Mankara.
Yeah. I reckon he'll bring people to the VFL. I reckon it's so exciting. I think he'll play seniors before the end of the year.
I meant to ask Charlie this, but do you know what? Was he injured or was he just coming off what was the holdback with him?
Yeah, I'm the wrong guy to ask. You know, I tune out preseason.
I'm asking you. I need to ask someone more informed.
But no, I think he'll. I don't know. I'm just like trolling the internet now.
Yeah, no, apparently the Jai Menzies during the week was saying that some of the stuff he does at training has to be seen to be believed. And that's really exciting, isn't it?
Yeah, he's 187 centimetres.
Tall.
So he's it would be very exciting, but really can't wait to see how he goes in the VFL.
And imagine when once Waller's back off his injury, those two in the VFL running around in the VFL.
Or the seniors later in the year.
Look out.
Brilliant. Well, look, on that note, there ends Fiona's forecast number two. We'll be back Monday evening with the podcast proper, hopefully talking about a win. So, see everyone at the game tomorrow, and go Bombers.
Good night.